God. Hey, give him what's due his name today. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Welcome to church this morning. We are Detroit World Outreach, and we thank you so much for joining us today. Welcome to those guests and family that are in the house and our media church that are viewing online. Thank you so much for worshiping Jesus with us today. Praise God. We are at 7155 Norwood Avenue in Allen Park, Michigan. Well, we welcome you to join us in the house anytime there is a seat in the house with your name on it, in Jesus' name. If you are able, please stand with me as we prepare to confess God's word over our lives in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Repeat after me. I am blessed, prosperous, redeemed, forgiven, talented, creative. I'm confident, secure. Discipline, focus, prepared, qualified. I'm motivated. Say it again. I'm motivated. I'm valuable. I'm free. Determined.
Like you. Jesus. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for your presence. We thank you, Father God, for all that you do for us, all that you have done for us, and the things that you are doing right now. Father God, we may not see it. We trust you because we know you're doing it. And Father God, we want to thank you and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Good to see all the smiling faces on this Palm Sunday morning. This is a great day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad about it. Amen. We thank God for those who are joining us in our main sanctuary, and we're going to continue the way of giving and sowing unto the Lord and by ways of our tithes and our offerings. And if you need an offering envelope, just raise your hands. Now helps ministers will serve you. You can also give securely online at dwo.org, or you can download the app from your Apple or Android store. You have not done so yet. You can text DWO APP to 833-774-6233, or you can scan our DWO QR code, and that will help you download the app and direct you to how you can sow into the ministry. For those who are at home and watching online, we want to thank God for our media church family. And you can also continue to mail in your tithes and or offering to Detroit World Outreach at 7155 Norwood Avenue, Allen Park, Michigan, 48101. Amen. Praise God. You know, Psalms 103, verses 1 and 2 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not his benefits." And you know there's benefits in serving God. Amen? You know, they're not like some jobs today. They hire you, but they don't want to give you no benefits. But God always has benefits for you. Amen. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6, in the God's Word version, it says, "Remember this, the farmer who plants few seeds will have a very small harvest. But the farmer who plants because he has received God's blessings will receive a harvest of God's blessings in return. Each of you should give whatever you have decided. You shouldn't be sorry that you have that you gave or feel forced to give, since God loves a cheerful giver. Besides, God will give his constantly overflowing kindness. Then, when you always have everything you need, you can do more and do more good things." Amen. We serve a generous God. Amen. I used to work for a guy who was just stingy. Cheap, you know. He'd do the work and didn't want to pay you right. God ain't like that. God is not like that. We have a generous God. You know, I was buying a car one day, so I went to my credit union and pre-qualified for how much I wanted to spend. Then I went car shopping. I was kind of got sticker shot because what I wanted to spend wasn't what they want me to pay. But you know, I just trusted God. I saw some vehicles on the lot that were more than what I wanted to pay, and the guy said, well, I got one more for you to look at. So I went and looked at that. I liked it. I drove it. And I came back and I told him, because sometimes you got to be bold enough. Stand on the word. They wanted $7,000 more than what I wanted to pay. So I looked at him. I said, I'm already pre-qualified. This is what I want to pay. And he looked at me like I was crazy. And he said, well, he went into the office, stayed there for a minute, came back and said, when do you want to pick it up? That's a generous guy. Amen. So sometimes you got to be bold enough to stand on the promises and proclaim it. Amen. Praise God. Has everyone had an opportunity to prepare their seed? Let us all stand and raise them unto the Lord. Heavenly Father God, we thank you, Lord, for every sower today, my Father God. We know, Heavenly Father God, that it is you who will bless us and not we ourselves, my Father God. We thank you, Father God, that we continue, my Father God, knowing that we're sowing into good ground, we're sowing into good stewardship, and we're sowing to my Father God to expand the kingdom of God. We thank you, Father God, for your goodness. We thank you, Father God, for your generosity that you give unto us. And Father God, we want to truly bless you, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Now please follow the leading of the ushers as you come to sow your seed to the, at the altar.
Let's raise our hands to the offering today. Father, we come in the name of Jesus through the power and might of your Spirit, thanking you for your love, grace, and mercy. And Father, for the honor and privilege, Father, to lay our tithes and lay our offerings on this altar of worship today, God. Father, we ask that you receive it with gladness, Father. Father, you must receive it, Father, with increase in mind according to your word, Father. Father, we thank for integrity and mission of this house, God. Every diamond dollar is being used, Father, according to your word, will, and way, increasing the kingdom purpose, Father. So we declare right now There's no lack in this house. There's no lack in our houses, Bob, for you're truly our shepherd, and we will not want for everything. We declare our accounts are overflowing. 30, 60, 100 return, Father, as we follow your heart, God, Father. Father, we ask, God, as the word goes forth in my power, Father, bring a return on the word as well that will be given, God. Father, we thank you for this honor and privilege to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Daughter Zariah. Shirley, granddaughter Journey. Jasmine is a twin. Tamika, other twin. Jamila is my goddaughter. Collis. Kathy. Right over here. JC. And these are new kids.
What a wonderful child.
And Patterson. They new kids.
All right, come on, let's give it up for Deacon James and company.
We need you guys to squeeze in tiny.
Bless.
20-year photo. Deacon James gets bragging rights on the first quarter. The next one will be in June. So he's going to get his picture in the foyer and full bragging rights.
Congratulations, yes. Deacon yes. James. Yes. Hold yes. that. Yes. You may want to have your beautiful bride hold one along with you. Give it up for Deacon James and company. God bless you all. Thank you for being here. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. We love Deacon James. All right. Are you having a good time so far? Let me hear you. Are you having a good time? Online? I can't hear you, but are you having a good time online? Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. But right now, we want you to give it up for the Detroit World Outreach Children's Ministry. Give it up.
DWO family, you are invited to attend a special evening of worship as the DWO Worship Creative Ministry presents another Worship and Flow Series event and welcomes the God of Praise and Worship Group. This event will take place Saturday, April 27th at 5 p.m. The God of Praise and Worship Group is a network of anointed musicians and worship leaders combining their gifts to glorify God through spectacular praise and worship. And we are so excited to host this awesome team of believers. So save the date, Saturday, April 27th at 5 p.m. here at DWO. See you at the altar and come ready to worship, dance, and shout. Awesome family, it is the resurrection time frame once again, and we would like to encourage you to make plans to be with us during these joyous occasions. Join us Friday, March 29th at 12 noon for a Good Friday gathering as we commemorate the crucifixion and death of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ through worship, word, communion, and special videos. Please make special plans to be with us Sunday, March 31st for our Resurrection Sunday gathering at 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. That's right, two gatherings to choose from. There will be special dance and drama to commemorate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But wait, we have special surprise for everyone. Immediately following the 10 a.m. Resurrection Sunday gathering, there will be a full fellowship dinner served in the lower level. The menu is barbecue ribs, baked chicken, macaroni and cheese, greens, green beans, and more, along with candy giveaways for the children. This day is going to be simply amazing. So save the date and your appetite, and we'll see you there. DWO Membership Class. Are you interested in membership at DWO? Join us for the DWO Membership Class starting Sunday, April 7th. This is a four-week class that will cover our mission and vision, our core values, and our statement of faith, as well as how you can get involved. The DWO Membership Class will be held Sundays at 12:30 after the 10 a.m. gathering in the lower level starting April 7th. For more information, call DWO at 313-255-2222 or email mdk@dwo.org.
Of their branches, as the people's palms grasped and then brandished those leafy emblems of both festival and rebellion. These were a people who felt as though they had already spent their second, third, and last chances on zealots, men like Barabbas and that now famous Maccabean. But this Jesus, this new champion, was riding into Jerusalem on a donkey as Zechariah had envisioned him. This king was coming to daughter Zion to take the wicked Roman chariots away from Ephraim. Surely this Jesus was the one to bring God's people salvation. Surely he was the one pictured all across the prophet's hopeful panorama. So they shouted, "Save us, please." They cried, "Hosanna, Hosanna." And this Jesus would answer yes to their cry of "Save us, save us," but not in the way they expected. Not by the violent overthrow predicted by their palmy political propaganda. For the humility of that donkey was nothing compared to the way he would answer their shouts of Hosanna. For the path on which he rode took him not to a throne, but to a court. Not to a place fit for a heavenly king, but to the feet of an earthly lord. It was there, before another crowd, in the hands of Pilate, whom God endowed with the power to answer the shouts rising loud, demanding crucifixion for this man who was so recently avowed as Hosanna by those who had laid down a pathway of both palm branch and personal shroud. It was there that he would show how he would answer both crowds, both the Hosanna save us cry and the incessant crucify. For what was missed by each tribe, by those who cried out their Hosanna boast and those who cried that this man should be nailed upon two posts, is that Jesus would say no to neither request. Instead, he would say yes to both. In fact, he would accomplish salvation by such infliction. He would be Hosanna by undergoing crucifixion. He would say yes to cries of love and yes to cries of hate. And for us, it is good news that he answered this way. For we too cry Hosanna. We too need to be saved. But we also cry crucify him. We also are filled with hate. We need to be rescued from our evil, but when goodness comes to us, we take what is good and by our evil hang it on a cross. But this is how he saves us. This is how he loves us. He answered our cry of need and our cry of hate with one final yes poured out as he cried, so that the sin that put him on the cross he paid for as he died, and the salvation for which we asked by his yes he supplied. So come, lay down your branches and come lift up your palms, for the King of our salvation said yes to the night of death so that he could raise the light of dawn.
Good morning, DWO family, here in the sanctuary and online. We welcome you to Detroit World Outreach. Trying to find an easy and fast way to give your tithes and offerings? You can securely give online by downloading the DWO app for Apple and Android users, or text DWO app to 833-774-6233. Get connected, like and share us on Facebook and Instagram. Having difficulties in these trying times? Call our DWO 24-hour prayer line at 313-999-9730. Or you can email us at prayer@dwo.org. Don't have a phone or tablet? Take a prayer card home. You can receive one from our Help Ministry team members. When it's all filled out, just leave it at the office and we will be in agreement with you. At this time, we would like to dismiss all middle school and high school students to their designated classes. There are Help Ministry workers located at the rear of the sanctuary to assist you. Thank you for joining us on this awesome day.
He knows my name, every breath that I take, every move that I make, every tear that I cry. He knows my name when I'm overwhelmed by the pain, can't see the light of day. I know I'll be just
that you indeed know our name. You know us. You're a very personal God, and you care deeply for each and every one of us. Your word says that before we were formed in our mother's womb, you knew us. God, we stand in awe of the goodness that you have bestowed upon us as your children, and we thank you for it. We relish in it, dear God. And Father, today I thank you that as we prepare to study your word, that Holy Spirit is already here to illuminate truth to us as we study together. I thank you, God, that revelation knowledge, revelation wisdom is flowing freely. Dear Lord, I thank you that as your gift to this body, you're hiding me in the ultimate gift of yourself to this world. Dear God, make my voice sound like yours. May my words be the words that you desire to have spoken. Father, I am yours. We are yours to command. Have your way, I pray, in Jesus' name. And all in agreement said, amen. Praise God. Before you have your seats this morning, would you take the opportunity to greet one another around you, shake a few hands, hug a few necks. Let everybody know how much you're happy to see them. If you're not into that, you can just wave. Some people don't like hugging. Just wave. Praise God. To our media church family, those of you that are watching and participating from the top of the world to the bottom and all the way around the middle, we welcome you today to Detroit World Outreach, and we say good morning to you from Eastern Standard Time. Congregation, can we give our national, international media family a great clap welcome? Praise God. Praise God. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord today. We want to take the time to honor all of our first-time guests who are here. Praise the Lord. If it is your first time with us, would you slip up your hand? We want to get a gift in your hand. We desire here at Detroit, we got a lot of guests in here today. We want to get something in your hand. If you'll fill that out, praise the Lord. We want to be a blessing to you. It is our endeavor, it is our desire to not only get connected with you, but also stay connected with you, because we want to do life together with you. I want to be your pastor, and all of these beautiful people that you see all around you want to do life together with you. Amen. We weren't created to be an island. We were created to be a part of a community. And we want you to be a part of the community here at Detroit World Outreach. We've got a saying here: if you're looking for a church, quit looking, because we want you right here. Amen? Let's give it up for all of our first-time guests. We honor you. We bless you in Jesus' name. We don't call you visitors. Visitors come and go. Guests come and stay. Amen? If you're going to be a visitor anywhere, you're going to go and visit the jail, because you're going to be visiting someone in the jail. But you're not going to be a guest of the jail, because you're not going to go and stay at the jail. Visitors come and go. Guests come and stay. We want you to stay here. Amen? Praise God. How many of you got your Bibles with you today? Hallelujah. Let's get them high in the air as we prepare to confess the word of the Lord over our lives today. I want you to say it with me with boldness and authority. This is my Bible. This is God's word speaking to me. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. And I can do what it says I can do. Today I will be taught his word. I confess that my soul is open and receptive. My spirit man is perfectly aligned. And my life will be changed. In Jesus' name. And if you believe it, would you say, praise the Lord. Turn with me, beloved, if you will, to Matthew's gospel this morning. Matthew chapter 21. And as you are turning there, I'd like to share a few things with you. Today we have a ministry fair that is taking place immediately after the conclusion of our Sunday morning gathering. And that is taking place on the lower level. We have many ministries here in Detroit World Outreach, and we would love for you to get connected with one of those, and we'd love to share them with you. We don't keep things to ourselves here and hold everything super tight. We don't grab a hold of this keyboard and say, nobody else can play it. But we want to share ministry with you and invite you to come and join in and get connected in the areas that you're talented and that you are anointed to serve in. So make sure to go ahead and join us this morning after final benediction. I want to share a couple of testimonies with you. Praise the Lord. We just have them coming into the church consistently, and I'm so thankful to the Lord for that. And I'm looking forward to the day that we see the individuals. Some of them are here, some of them are not. That they come in and they testify for themselves. But I learned this week on Thursday evening of one sister that I had prayed for back when we were serving at our Joy Road campus. She came in a wheelchair and was unable to walk. She came on graduation Sunday, which was about 9 months or so ago. And I remember telling her these words. I says, you have a right to walk, just like I do, just like everybody else does. You have a right to walk, because divine healing is not only the children's bread, but it's provided in the blood atonement. And I prayed, and she went on her way, and I learned this week, praise God, that she is out of a wheelchair and that she's walking fine. We give the Lord praise for that. Amen. Praise God. And I received another testimony from one of our teammates here. We don't call people volunteers, praise God. People serve on a team, praise God. They want to be part of a team. And one of our teammates wrote me this, said, good morning, Bishop. I have a testimony. I went to get my driver's license renewed, but failed my eye exam. I asked if I could come back the same day within a few hours. I went home, I called the church, got a hold of Pastor Frank. He prayed for me. I went back and passed my eye exam. The Lord is good. Come on, somebody shout. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You could just stay right there at the Secretary of State, get a hold of Pastor Frank. Hallelujah. Amen. But God worked it all out. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 21. I trust that you've turned there by now. We are going to read the first 11 verses of this chapter. Follow along with me. I'm using the New King James Version, of course, which is our pulpit Bible here at Detroit World Outreach. It says this, now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them. Everybody say, loose them. Loose them. Didn't say bind them. Said, loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately, somebody say immediately. And immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt and laid their clothes on them and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road, and others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitude who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? So the multitudes said, This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. This morning, I'd like to take as a title for our message, Every Palm Has a Purpose. Every palm has a purpose. I could preach this message to you in about 60 seconds by telling you that God has purpose and intention attached to everything he does. You need to know that. He has purpose and intention attached to everything he does. This morning, as we celebrate Palm Sunday, this was the day, of course, over 2,000 years ago, that Jesus made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem just a few days before his death. As we consider our text this morning, we see that Jesus' disciples followed his directions and prepared the donkey for Jesus to sit on by placing clothes on them. We likely can also see that Jesus traveled a great distance that was already prepared for him with clothes and with palm branches that have been laid out by the crowds of people. As I said, the Lord has purpose and intention attached to everything he does. Every one of those palm branches that were cut from the tree and placed on the road had a purpose. Everything that God has ever done has a purpose. And I find in my life, here and now, in 2024, that I encounter so many people, even some who are of the faith, that have a feeling that they have no purpose, that they're just existing here on this earth. But I want you to know, beloved, that God formed you, your inner parts, the Bible says. And before you were even formed, he knew you. And if he knew you, he had a purpose for you, because you would not have been created by God without purpose and intention attached to your life. Do I have a witness here today? Oh, praise God. Praise God. I remember the triumphal entry of Jesus into my life many years ago as a teenager that was full of anger, a teenager full of sadness, a teenager that was a bully, a teenager that was an outright wreck, and a teenager that hated people. And I promise you this, God specializes in divine reversals. Romans 8:28 says, God will cause all things to work together for the good of them that love him and are called according to his purpose. And God took an angry child, a child that was full of wrath, a child that was full of anger, and turned him into an individual that has a passionate heart, that loves people. And I want you to know that you that are here, and to all of the world, no matter what you have done to me, if you have wronged me in any way, I want you to know that I love you, because God is love. I cannot say that I hate anyone, because now I would then be contradicting scripture about what it means to be a devoted follower of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hate has no intention, no purpose, and no place in this life. When Jesus made his triumphal entry into your life, he dealt with you. And if there was hatred, if there was issue that you had to deal with, what did he do? He washed you and he made you clean. Isaiah tells us of the divine blood atonement, that he carried our sins, he carried our sicknesses, he bore our griefs and bore our sorrows and gave us his peace. Every drop of blood that was spilled out on the cross was dropped and spilled with purpose and intention attached to it. And it had your name written on it, beloved. I'm redeemed not because I'm good. I'm redeemed not because of my works. I'm redeemed because of how good God is. I'm redeemed because of his purpose. I'm redeemed because of his intention. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So, as we consider the triumphal entry, we remember the triumphal entry of our Savior into this world. He was preparing to see the commencement of his ministry, the Lord Jesus Christ. For 30 years he was hidden. 30 years. He did the work that God told him to do. He did what his father told him to do. But at age 30, he announced his public ministry. He announced that he was the Messiah. He was the one whom God had sent. And for 3 years, he continued to do the work. And as he did the work, it ultimately commenced at the cross. And on the road to the cross was the triumphal entry. Now, in order for this to take place, directions had to be followed. Amen? Because Scripture interprets Scripture, right? Scripture fulfills Scripture. It says right here, all this was done. What is all of this? Jesus' instructions to the disciples, go get that donkey, bring it over here. Okay? All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, this is Zechariah's prophecy, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you. When you set out to do anything in your life, you follow directions. Now, I got to be honest with you. These days I have, when I buy something, I have people put it together for me. But years ago, I would have to put things together. And most men that I know, when they buy something, they just throw the directions away. Are there any men here that would honestly admit to just that you bought something and you just threw the directions straight into garbage? And yeah, praise God. God bless all three of you, four of you, for your honesty. And the rest of you, I pray the altars will be open for repentance at the conclusion of today's message. How many sisters have ever done that? God bless. The sisters are hearing from God. They're responding. Give the sisters a hand. God bless you, sisters. But we learn we don't do that. You don't throw away directions. My wife is what many of you don't know. She confessed it today, so I have no problem in saying that. She don't like to cook. That's why we are famously known at so many different restaurants. Praise God. But she loves to bake. And she makes all of these recipes of cakes and cookies especially. And she puts these recipes out on the internet for other people that may want to learn what she has made. And if you take the recipe and do what she told you to do, you're going to get the product that she produced. But if you take that recipe and say, I don't have any baking soda, so I'm gonna just use some baking powder. I don't have any almond extract, so I'm going to just use this vanilla extract. I I don't have a pinch of this, but I do have a pinch of yeast. Yeah, you use that, put that in your stove and see how get a cookie foot tall. Why? Because you have not followed the directions. You have not followed the recipe. And if you don't follow God's directions as outlined in Scripture, do not expect to see success. Now, I know that that is not the shouting and aisle running declaration that you may want to hear, but I want to tell you something, beloved. What is written in Scripture is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. It is our guidepost for living. Amen? And if we think that we can deviate from Scripture or take parts of it and not all of it, and live our life from the parts that we like, and be successful in this life using just the parts here and there without applying all of the word, we are only deceiving ourselves. Culture wants us to bow at its feet. We don't follow culture. Truth is not relative to the time that we're living in. Joyce Meyer said this last week. Truth doesn't change, beloved. Truth is God's word. That is our foundation, and that is what we live by. Anything else will lead us into disaster. Come on, somebody. When we prepare things, we follow directions. And on the triumphal entry day, Jesus followed the directions that were spoken by the prophet. Amen? So why should we follow the directions? Number one, if you're taking notes, write this down. The Lord's directions always has purpose attached. I told you I could sum up the message in 60 seconds. I did that earlier. That way, if I have to cut it short, you already know where I'm going. Praise the Lord. The Lord's directions always have purpose attached. You can see that clearly outlined in the directions of the first three verses of our text. Jesus told his disciples what? He told them where to go. He told them what to say. And he told them what to do. And what do you know? They actually did it. When Jesus speaks and when the word speaks to you, listen and do it. Oh, I don't understand this, Bishop Andre. I don't understand that. I don't know about this. Sometimes you are not going to grasp a full understanding in the immediate. But I guarantee you this truth, that as you follow after the heart of God, it will be revealed to you and you will understand, especially after further study. I have come to learn when I don't understand when God is telling me to do something, because he's not asking me to understand. He's asking me to obey. Jesus didn't put this out on the table for debate. People want to debate the word. You can't. If you want to debate the word, you might as well go and do your thing, because I can't run with that. I don't expect to have any success if I want to debate the word. But if I follow the word and align the word and allow the word to have total dominion in my life, then yes, I expect to be successful in everything that I touch. You say, well, what if the Holy Spirit doesn't lead you this or that? Listen, I believe, according to the word in Joshua chapter 1 and verse number 8, just after the death of Moses, Joshua assumes leadership of the children of Israel, and the Lord says to him, if you will meditate on my word, if you will meditate on my word, in other words, you be in the word, you pray, you study his word, then whatever you do, wherever you go, you will make your way prosperous. You. He's saying to Joshua, you are going to make your way prosperous. Rosalind, you are. I'm not going to do it for you, but I'm empowering you because you've meditated on my word. and you are going to make your way prosperous. Glory to God. In other words, once you've meditated on the word, make a decision and God will back it. Come on, somebody shout somebody. Yes, the Holy Spirit divinely leads and divinely directs, but there are a lot of times in life that you have to just follow the precepts of Scripture. And when you don't know whether to turn to the right or to the left, you know that you've meditated on the word, you know that you've been in God's presence, I believe He will entrust the decision to you. I believe He trusts you when you meditate on His word. What blocks the leading and direction of the Holy Spirit is a word that some may have struggled with in their life. It's called pride. Pride blocks you from meditating on the word. Pride blocks you from growing in the things of God. Pride blocks you from hearing the voice of God. James chapter 4 and verse number 6 says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Let me explain humility for just a moment, because a lot of people think humility is ripping away a person's self-worth. That's not humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. Write this down. I've said it before. Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but it's thinking about yourself less. Do you get that? Humility is not thinking less of yourself, but it's thinking of yourself less, right? And so if God resists the proud say, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to meditate on the word. I'm not going to pray. I'm not going to seek the Lord's face. I'm not going to do what His word says. I'm going to do things my way. Every time I ever put anything together in my early days of life, buying something and didn't follow the directions, it never turned out right. And then Danielle would come along and she would say, where are the directions? And I say, I threw them out. What'd you throw them out for? I said, I don't need them. Does it take a rocket scientist to put a barbecue together? Well, it took someone else other than me, because that thing, after I took it apart, put it back together again, that thing still wobbled for years. Now, I haven't barbecued now in over 15 years. That's about the last time I barbecued. So I'm a little rusty, but I used to be able to cook some good ribs, glory to God. It was so good, it'd make a Catholic shout. And I apologize if there's any Catholics in here, Catholics on my broadcast here, praise the Lord. I love you, I bless you, praise the Lord. But I know how quiet you like to be in your church. We shout over here at DWO, praise God. If you had my ribs back in the day, you'd shout, praise the Lord. And you'd shake a little bit too. Would you get them in your mouth? Somebody ought to say amen. You all know what I'm talking about. You know when you get that food in you. I get distracted while I'm preaching when they're cooking on the lower level. Lord have mercy. And we're cooking next week, praise God. We hope you're here for Resurrection Sunday. There's a full dinner. Ain't no church ever done that before. Full dinner, free. Next Sunday, you're not going to want to miss it. Praise the Lord. Pride says, I don't need to follow directions. Pride says, I don't need to follow the instruction of the Lord. But do you know that I regularly get directions from my bishop, from my pastor, from my father in the Lord? And you want to know what I do, what they tell me to do. I don't second question it. I do what I'm told. Why? Because they have walked the road before me, right? Now, There's a lot of people that want to share their opinions with me. Do this, don't do this, don't do that. And I love getting people's opinions. Please continue to share them with me. But regarding decisions, I'm going to use the wisdom of those who have walked the road before me, right? And so until you've been a pastor for at least how long I've been, that's 21 years, and you've gotten your proper education in that, I'm not going to dismiss what you have to say, but I'm going to listen to what my Father and the Lord has to say. Because he's retired now, and he went to a church with 100 and left it with 16,000 members. Praise God. I think he knows what he's doing. I think Dr. Tony Evans knows what he's doing. I think Pastor George Pearson's and Dr. Bill Winston, I think those guys know what they're doing. And so when it's spoken into my life, praise God, I look at the fruit, praise the Lord, and I see it. And I don't have to second question it because they have walked the road before me. Amen. So, I want you to understand that it's important that as you consider our text in the triumphal entry, the disciples didn't debate or argue with Jesus. They did what he said. Jesus had authority over them. They were men of authority that were under authority. And the best way that I could illustrate this is in the fact that your child doesn't tell you what to do. Your 5-year-old does not tell you how to discipline him or her. Now they can make an attempt to do that, but they ain't going to get very far. Am I talking to any moms or dads in the house today? All right. Moving along. Point number 2. Write this down. Write this down. We're moving quick now. The Lord's directions always confirm Scripture.
Amen.
The Lord's directions always confirm Scripture. The words of Jesus, I had to fulfill that which was spoken by the prophet. He had to fulfill what? Zechariah's prophecy. Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you. Can I tell you something? God, his word, and his will are inseparable. God talks to me. Yes, he does. He does. He leads us and he guides us. I'm very thankful for that. But you cannot tell me that God is leading you somewhere that are outside of the parameters of Scripture. Because if you do, I'm going to tell you, you're listening to what is known as a familiar spirit. Right? And that's not the Holy Spirit. There's only one spirit that you want to listen to, friends, and that's the Holy Spirit. Or some people say the Holy Ghost. They say Holy Ghost a lot in the South. But in the North, we say Holy Spirit. Same thing. Praise God. In Scripture, depending on your translation that you use, it says Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. They're the same. Part of the Godhead. 3 in 1. Jesus intended, beloved, to fulfill Scripture, to do God's will, because he knew that he couldn't separate the two, nor did he have a desire to. How can I say that? How could I say that Jesus didn't have a desire not to fulfill the will of God, at least concerning this area? Because if you look in John chapter 4 and verse 34, Jesus said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish that work. Meat is what sustains you. I've told this to you before. Meat sustains you. We have a lot of vegetarians and vegan people, and you have found a way to get protein from other things. So your meatless hamburgers and meatless steaks, they sustain you. But you take them away, right? And you've taken away your life source. Jesus said, my life source is to do the will of God. Yeah. I'm sustained by doing the will of God. And not only doing it, but finishing it. Finishing it. Lord, the directions that God gives will always confirm that which is in Scripture. When seeking God's will, you don't just expect something to fall out of the sky and land on your plate. Well, sometimes we've prayed for things like that, right? I'll tell you this, you can't steer a parked car. So get in your spiritual car, turn the ignition on, put it in drive, floor the gas. My wife says I floor the gas. I do speed up quick, but I don't speed, if that makes sense. I speed up quick, but I don't speed. Because I'll look down, I got all of my cars now, they have the digital dash, except my older vintage cars. I'll look, it'll be 96. I say, oh, I got to slow down. And then I take my, you know, because I've accelerated fast. But it's not my intention to speed, so I take my foot off of that accelerator and bring it down right to 70. Praise God. And I stay right at 70. And there's people that they don't like that, and they'll honk and their horn and flash their brights, but I am not going to speed. I'm not going to break that law. But I like speeding up quick. I like the feel of it. Anybody like speed here? Praise God. I see you, Joey. I know what you drive. You're going to take me for a ride Tuesday. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He offered me the keys. Praise God. I ain't going to tell you what he's got. That's his business. Praise the Lord. But it's something I like. Praise God. So I want to tell you, God works in order. Perfect order. Everybody say perfect order. So if he's speaking to you, if he's leading you, if someone's prophesying over your life, you go back to the scripture and say, God, where is this? And what does it mean concerning me? And you, I a lot of preachers back in the 70s and 80s, they always say, you need to get a revelation. You need to get a revelation. And that was pretty popular, but I say you need to get a vision, because you get a revelation with your eyes closed, but you get a vision with your eyes open, and your eyes need to be open so that you're seeing, praise God, where you're at and what God is speaking to you. Amen? God's directions are specific, they're scriptural, praise God, but also you can trust, write this down if you're taking notes. Number three, you can trust what God says. Hallelujah. You've trusted him with your heart. You've trusted him for the forgiveness of sin. But so many people struggle with the other areas that he gives us instruction and he leads us and he directs us. But we say, oh, no, we don't want to do that. Listen, the disciples found things just as Jesus told them that they would. He said, go over here and you're going to find the donkey and the colt. They're going to be there, okay? We as Christians can count on God's directions to be accurate. If God said it, people say, if God said it, I believe it, it's settled. No, take you believe out. Say, if God said it, it's settled. Because it don't matter if you believe it or not. If God said it, it's settled. Have I got a witness up in here? Praise God. If God said it, it's settled. I'll need to insert myself here. Praise God. If God said it, it's settled. Problems happen when we don't see the manifestation of the will of God instantly. That's called walking by sight. And 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 7 tells us we walk by faith and not by sight. If we saw everything right in front of us, there would be no need for faith. If we knew the end, there would be no need for faith, right? But God calls us to trust him. I want you to know you can depend on God. Many of you may remember the old gospel song. It was sang in the choir in the early 2000s. I believe even before that, because it was at Liberty Temple in some of their archives. It says, you can depend on God. through the storm, through the rain, through sickness and through pain, you can depend on God. Can I tell you something? He's enough. Look at someone and say, Jesus is enough. Hallelujah. Rest in the fact that the character and the intention of God does not change. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse number 8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. In other words, he's not going to go around changing his mind. Remember, because if God said it, it's settled. Well, God, how's that going to work? This has been stripped away from me, and I'm no longer a part of this or part of that. If God said it, it's settled. But people will say, well, I'm just going to stand in faith and wait on the manifestation. That's great. Stand in faith. But Abraham's faith was perfected in his works. So don't stay idle. Don't just sit on the pew. Prepare for it. Move toward it. You don't see it happening? Doesn't matter. You're not walking by what you see. You're not walking by what you sense. Praise God. You're walking by faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. So hear the word of God today. Move forward. I can't see it, Bishop. Move forward. Did God say it? Move forward. Hallelujah. And a lot of times you may not see exactly what you would like to see, but you will see what God told you you will see, just as the disciples did. Amen? Number four, as I prepare to close, we have a partnership with God. I am humbled, so humbled and blessed, knowing this truth, that God would use someone like me, that God would use many of the people that are the unlikelies of this world to accomplish his work through partnership. Yeah, we all partner with God in our giving in order that the work of the ministry goes forward. But to think that God would use you to teach his word, to preach his word, to shepherd his flock. I was overwhelmed when God called me to the ministry and I said yes, because I really didn't want to be in ministry. I wanted to be an attorney. That was my desire. I wanted to be an attorney. And I said yes to the Lord. I said, I'll preach, but I ain't going to pastor, because I saw what my pastor went through. But God called me to pastor. And at a very early age, I submitted to that call. And I thank the Lord that I did. It certainly is not easy. And a lot of days, it's not fun. But life isn't always easy, friend. Life isn't always fun. But you will always be fulfilled when you are doing the work of God. So don't run from what God tells you to do. Do it. Do it. And know that you are in a partnership with him, accomplishing his work on earth as it already is where? In heaven. Amen? Now, because, and read verses 8 through 11, really study that when you get home of the 21st chapter. Because Jesus' directions were followed, the disciples were able to take part in a great day of celebration because God's word was fulfilled. When you obey God and you know God's word is being fulfilled, and you are partnering with God in what he is doing, you will have great fulfillment, knowing that, hey, I listened to him, I obeyed him, this is what his word says concerning me, and now we're in a day of celebration. the triumphal entry into Zion, into the holy city Jerusalem, praise God, was a day of celebration. And because of the partnership that they had with the Lord Jesus Christ, they were blessed also as a result. I also call that blessed by association. Amen? Whenever God tells us to do something, beloved, we can look back over our lives and we see His will fulfilled, regardless if we understood it or not. But God's glory is revealed in partnership. And what happens as a result is destiny is revealed, because you had the faith to take the next step in your destiny walk. Destiny is not a destination. It is a journey that you are on. And you go from step to step to step to step, and you continue to grow in Him. You don't get to a place where you clock out. You don't get to a place where it's one and done. I'm finished. No. No. So, on the triumphal entry, the Lord's directions had purpose attached. The Lord's directions confirmed Scripture. We know that we can trust what His Word says. And lastly, we can rejoice in the partnership that we have with Him. You receive His Word today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Would you stand to your feet? I want to pray for you. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank You for every soul that has gathered today. I pray, dear Lord, that we would be people of intentionality. Dear God, that we would endeavor to celebrate the partnership that we have with You, following Your directions as outlined in Your Word, not debating with You, not walking by sight, but walking by faith, and consistently hearing Your Word, dear God. And as we do that, dear Lord, I thank You that we can expect success, dear Lord, in any endeavor, because, God, we're not walking by ourselves. We're walking with You. You lead us, You direct us, and we will utilize our free will to submit to the Lordship of Christ and move forward in Jesus' name. And all who receive said amen. Amen. Prayer ministers, if you'll take your place at the front of the church very quickly. Hallelujah. Deacons and elders, those of you that are here, go ahead and make your way to the front as well. Praise the Lord, we're going to need your help. If you're here and you need prayer for any reason today, there's a sickness that's trying to attack your body and has no dominion over you. By His stripes you were healed. People say, well, why am I experiencing this? I'm not going to try to give you an intellectual answer, right, on that, because I'm not a doctor. I can't speak into that. But what I can speak into is God's Word. And His Word says, by His stripes you were healed. Amen. So I'm not dealing with your, but I'm sick, but I'm this. I'm dealing with your, I am healed. If you need healing today, we want to pray for you. If you're here today and you need to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, you've heard the message of the gospel. You've heard the word of faith. That is, that if we will confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, we shall be saved. If you're here today and you need to put that word into action, we're going to invite you forward in just a moment. And if you're here and you're away from God, and you know you're away from God, you know you're out of fellowship with Him, you haven't walked away from Him, you haven't denied Him, but you're out of fellowship with Him, today's your day to enter into agreement with brothers and sisters in Christ that love you and that want to see restoration and replenishment and renewal and divine reversals take place. And so if you're here today and you fit into any one of those categories, the altars are open for you. Would you come? Would you come? Pastor Johnny, will you lead us? Praise God. For the next few moments, as people are coming forward, you that are in your seats, please just continue. Worship the Lord. Pray for those that are here in the altar. We're here to serve you. Prayer for any reason, the altars are open for you today. Are you saved? Are you born again? You may need to ask the person next to you, listen, do you have pain in your body? Do you need prayer for anything? Ask the people that are around you and then take them by the hand and bring them to the Lord's altar. Benediction, blessing this morning. We're so glad that you're here. Please don't be in a hurry to leave. Please go to the lower level of the church as we have our ministry fair. I believe there's close to 20 different ministries that are represented. We want you to get plugged in, and we want you to serve with us. Our arms are open. We don't keep things to ourselves. We share them. If we expect to grow, we got to do what? Share. If you want to grow, you got to delegate to do what? Elevate. Praise God. And we want to delegate to you what God has blessed us to do. As we continue to do it, and we end up doing what? We grow together. The altars will remain open for a few more moments. Praise and worship will continue. Don't feel the need to rush out. Fellowship, spend some time with some people. Let everyone know how much you love them. Praise God. And don't forget to get your coffee as well. Coffee's on the lower level. Free for everybody. Would you lift your hand for the blessing all across the auditorium? May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant you His peace, in order that you may go forth this day with full assurance, knowing who you are in the Lord Jesus Christ, going forward in partnership with Him, following His directions, consulting the Word, and being with Him. All who receive, say amen. Amen. God bless you. We love you. We look forward to seeing you Thursday morning, 11 a.m. Good Friday, 12 noon. Don't miss it. I love you. God loves you. And remember this all the days of your life. Jesus is Lord. Be blessed this beautiful Sunday. The altars remain open.